I mean, you know a song's a piece of trash when you kick it off by crashing a car into a dumpster.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of 1001 Album Complaints. It's the show where friends, musicians, and general complainers dig deep into the backgrounds and stories behind some of history's most influential albums and bands, as immortalized in the list of the 1001 albums you must hear before you die. So I'm going to give some history on the band, on the album. We'll do some deep dives on a handful of the tracks. At the end, we'll all vote on whether you actually need to hear this album before you die, and then we'll randomly select next week's album. As usual, we want to thank you for spending some time with us today, and I wanted to open up this episode with a good decision, bad decision comparison for our artist today. So, first off, for our good decision, none other than Rick Rubin had suggested that this week's band rename themselves the Cobb County Crows, spelled with all K's. You know, KKK. Thankfully, the band refused that bit of insanity. Overall, a good decision. However, insanity was never too far away, so for our bad decision, the lead guitarist of today's band once took their tour bus and left the entire band stranded in New Orleans so that he could drive home early to Atlanta. Man, if that ain't some rock star shit right there, I don't know what is. So if you haven't guessed it yet, today we're talking about the Black Crows. My name is Adam. I've been playing music for 30 years, played professionally for over a decade, and today I'm going to be leading us through the debut album from the Black Crows. So this album is called Shake Your Moneymaker, a reference to an old Elmore James song that never actually made it onto the record. But what did make it onto the record was possibly the most potent cure, or remedy, for all the boy bands and hair metal that was dominant at the time. The Black Crows unleashed a rock and roll revival a little over 30 years ago that inspired a lot of kids, including a young me. So now that I've thrown any semblance of objectivity out the window, let's dive right into the opening track off this album. This is called Twice as Hard. Okay, once again, track one, side one, debut album. We love these tracks. So let's work our way around the studio today with our quick intros and those beloved tweet-length reviews. Let's throw it over to Alan. Thank you.
Damn it.
What do you got?
So this is Alan here, and my tweet-length review is, if you like reconstituted rock music that flagrantly imitates an iconic UK band from the 60s, delivered by two brothers who hate each other's guts, then I think Oasis might be your kind of band.
Well done, sir. All right, Phil, what do you got for us today?
Yeah, so I want to say that it was twice as hard to listen to this record this time around as it was 25 years ago. But I can't honestly say that. It goes down pretty easy, you know, like Georgia bourbon.
That's pretty a Southern comfort.
Pretty good. Yeah, not too bad. All right, all right.
And, yeah.
Well, there's a famous Miller Lite story, too, that maybe we'll get speaking of going down easy.
Rob, what do you got for us?
Guys, is this what it feels like to just relax and appreciate Lynyrd Skynyrd? That's what I was wondering all week. No, seriously, listening to the album Shake Your Moneymaker was a ton of fun. Don't get me wrong, but are these guys really breaking new ground? Are they actually to blame for a million other Starbucks-friendly Americana throwback acts? Are they 100% necessary to hear? I'm looking forward to getting into it.
TBD, all right.
I feel like if Rob has to ask those questions, then we kind of know the answers.
Yeah, I'm a little worried, Rob. I see which way this is going already from the top. All right, this is Adam. So, loud guitars, check. Solid drummer, check. Amazing keyboard player, check. Virtually unintelligible and power-hungry, cocaine-crazed lead singer, check. So overall, the story of the Black Crowes is a story of an omnipresent sibling rivalry, narcissism, control, potential bipolar disorder, and loads of drugs. So the quintessential American rock and roll. Now, I said there at the top that I've always loved this band, but I didn't really think of this band as a group. So I read a book this week by Steve Gorman. It was called Hard to Handle: The Life and Death of the Black Crowes. And he had made that comparison of the difference between a band and a group. And in my head, I think of Iron Maiden as a group, right? When you go on Wikipedia and you look at their Gantt chart, their timeline, there's like 60 members of the band over 40 years. The Black Crowes are kind of the same.
It's like Disney on Ice.
Exactly. They've got 17 members of the band that have filtered in and out between 1990 and 2008.
Well, hold on. To be fair, that is most groups that last longer than 20 years, right? I mean, the Temptations are still out there touring, but...
with the exception, what was it? Wasn't U2 and Weird Al's band? It's the same lineup for 35 years or something.
Yeah, U2 is the same four terrible musicians for like over 40 years.
So in that book that was written by the drummer, he definitely gives a good glimpse of how problems that he saw that started in 1987 basically stuck around for 25 years and ultimately killed the band. I think now, whatever it is, 32 years later, they're actually still touring. I think it's just the two brothers and they have a bunch of fill-in players. I'm sure they still rock. But 1987 is a great place to start, and that's because that's when a 22-year-old Steve Gorman, the drummer, dropped out of college and became the drummer of an Atlanta-based band called Marry My Hope. So the guys in Marry My Hope were also friends with another Atlanta-based rock band called Mr. Crow's Garden. In fact, it was Chris Robinson who met Steve Gorman at the bus station when he came down to Atlanta at 22 years old. So Chris Robinson and his younger brother, Rich Robinson, grew up in a suburb outside of Atlanta, and they formed Mr. Crow's Garden when they were still in high school, I think in 1984. So it's 1987, Rich the guitarist is 18, and Chris, his brother, the singer, and the guy who writes all the lyrics is 21 years old.
Can I say that the first thing that surprised me, so let me just say a little bit where I'm coming from. I didn't listen to this at all when it came out. I couldn't have cared less. And in fact, probably because of Adam just indicated his history with this record, but I've always associated this band with you guys, with Adam, Phil, and Tom, and your high school band.
Oh yeah, I definitely I think of this as Adam's band for sure, big time.
Oh man, yeah, you got me to a T.
But one thing that surprised me was this came out in 1990. I mean, that was much earlier than I was expecting. Because of course I remember hearing the singles and watching the videos. But I thought of them as a mid-90s band, not an early 90s band.
Yeah, I did as well. And I was sort of surprised to hear that. And seeing that helped me situate this a little bit more with sort of the Guns N' Roses, you know, Appetite era. And there being, you know, kind of in some senses like the only game in town where there wasn't a ton of decent rock music happening. So I guess they filled a void, but...
Well, yeah, they kind of sound like fresh Rolling Stones. Like in that way, they're a way better Rolling Stones than like Greta Van Fleet is Led Zeppelin.
Dude, don't taint this with that this horrendous band. God, you look at that guy dresses in, well, whatever.
Next week, we'll be reviewing Greta Van Fleet.
They're playing the basketball stadium in my town in a couple weeks.
Of course so they are. Yeah,
dude,
yeah.
The Kings deserve Greta Van Fleet.
So they're doing okay for themselves, man. All right, so Steve Gorman, the drummer, he comes down, he's playing with this group, Marry My Hope, but he eventually joins Mr. Crow's Garden. So early on, like I mentioned, Steve started to see the dysfunction between the brothers, Chris and Rich Robinson. And he tells a story that after an absolutely amazing gig, Chris, the older brother, was just simply unable to experience joy. And that is something that plagued them for their entire career, bordering on manic depressive behavior. And that was definitely something that, I mean, caused a lot of other band members to leave, but also that constant battling between the brothers. I mean, it's a pretty prolific career. They wrote a lot of good music, and it was mainly written by Chris and Rich Robinson.
Well, maybe we're going to get deeper into it, but since this is one of those bands that is somewhat defined by the sibling rivalry and on again, off again nature of their band, because they're fighting and they're on different tour buses and they won't talk to each other or they're friends again. Can we get a little bit into people who haven't been in a band might not realize how full of conflict and tension it is. You don't have to be brothers. I mean, I was in a band with Phil and we fought constantly. Sure.
It's really hard to spend hours a week locked in windowless rooms with people. Just like, it's just hard. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. You're not playing cards.
Well, and it's work. It's, I feel like imagine being coworkers with like some of your best friends.
Imagine being coworkers, but it's not just that. It's work in the sense that you're trying to accomplish a goal and yet there is no pay. The only payoff, if there is even a payoff, is just the glory of finishing the song or finishing the record that in all probability, no one but your friends is ever going to hear. And so, and at the same time, to make music, to make art of any sort, you have to make yourself very vulnerable. You're writing presumably personal material, or at the very least you're putting your playing out there to be judged by others. So it's like, you're already in a vulnerable position. I'm just saying that, and it wasn't just Phil and I, you know, we were in the same band with Tom, fought with Tom all the time. Yeah. In the same band with James, fought with James all the time. It's constant. I always likened it at the time.
It's kind of part of the fun.
It's kind of part of the fun. Alan and Phil are in a band currently, right? And I'm sure they fight. It's a little bit like a marriage, but there's five people involved, which means you not only have to keep in mind, you know, it's the complexity of not just one relationship, not just five relationships, if you're in a five-person band, but also all the interrelationships that you have to manage like before anything can happen. And on top of all that, there's no sex to cut the tension or makeup or anything like that.
Well, and that's before the drugs take hold.
But a lot of the times, Rob, like you said, like these guys, they're doing all that and they don't even get to go home to like different spots. Like they're all living in the same one bedroom apartment with like mattresses on the floor and there's rats everywhere. So imagine all that. And like, you can't even find a clean shower.
I'm just bringing it up as context because I think it is easy to poke fun at brothers who can't get along or Oasis, who was already referenced here, who can't get back together and make millions and millions of dollars or whatever. And they deserve to be poked fun at. Don't get me wrong. But
although I do respect leaving that much money on the table in the name of spite. Like I truly have respect for that.
It's like I hear the ghost of Tom on this conversation right now.
It's like, I will see to it that my children and his children's children have nothing.
I'm just saying it's a normal part of the deal of being in a band. And we have to acknowledge that when you're trying really hard to accomplish something, all those other attributes we mentioned, fighting is just a natural part of it.
I have a friend who did pretty well touring with some pop acts around the world. I mean, playing stadiums and stuff. And he said at that level, again, not like the homegrown band thing, but when you're playing with those type of pop acts, that you get to a certain level and everyone can play. It comes down to who do you want to spend 15 hours a day on a bus with? So it's like, you know, yeah, I get it. You can play, but are you an asshole? No. All right. You're in the band. Join us. Right. Who am I going to have fun with?
And it's that transition. Yeah. You referenced the difference between a homegrown band that feel like they're all in it together, like a team, which is one of the coolest parts about being in a band, right? Even an unsuccessful band. Yeah. Is you really feel like you're a part of a brotherhood or whatever versus a hired gun where the hierarchy in that, let's say, company is very well known. You're here to do a job and go home and that's it. That's your contribution. You don't decide if our music's going into Pepsi commercial or whatever and you have your salary and that's it. That's a totally different scenario, right?
Now that's funny though, because one of the things that Steve Gorman later in the career, even just, I think, you know, 5 to 10 years ago, they wanted to go back out on tour. And Chris Robinson basically told Steve Gorman, you're going to be salaried. I'll tell you how much you get per gig and that's it. Versus this like, hey, we built this thing together 30 years ago, the three of us.
Yeah.
So that was one of the reasons that ultimately drove him out of the band.
Well, that maybe last thought on this particular topic is that I read a Tom Petty biography that I really enjoyed some years back. And one of the things they attributed to the Heartbreakers playing together as a band for an extended period of time is that when Tom Petty got the record contract, they came for him, for Tom Petty. And he said, well, I want to bring my band. But then he had that difficult conversation early, before stardom, before hits, and said, here's how it's going to work. I'm the guy. You're the band. I love you guys.
So there were no delusions. Yeah, right.
But that's how it's going to work. And then it worked that way for, you know, 30 years.
So these guys have a great how did they get discovered story. So they had a manager when they were still playing small clubs, driving all their own gear around. They had a manager named Dave Macias who helped them with bookings, getting equipment to them from the gigs, borrowing cars and all that stuff. So he used to work in the mailroom in the Atlanta branch of A&M Records. So Dave Macias, he sends their demo using A&M letterhead to the LA office, hoping that someone would see the letterhead and think, oh, this must be like some talent rep from Atlanta. So they open it up, they listen to it, and it actually worked. And A&M gave the band some money for a professional demo. Just amazing.
<That's> awesome.
Just need letterhead. Back in the day, you just need letterhead, man. That's all you need.
What a hustle.
It's creative.
Right.
It's very creative. Didn't Phil send like a parking ticket or something from the city of Newark to somebody?
Yeah, I sent a parking ticket to Marty. An unpaid parking ticket to Marty about like, you know, bench warrant and stuff. It was hilarious. Really got him. It was great.
What you could do with Photoshop back in 1999.
I will admit though, the price I pay for it, it's almost like a murder. Like I got him so good that like every time I see Marty, there's always that little like what's right around the corner.
Got him on edge.
I feel like Marty, I can name a lot of similar stories that all involve Marty. So that's his wheelhouse, I think.
Sure.
It reminds me a little, sorry, it's already very tangential, but that creativity of how to get your foot in the door reminds me a little of the story of that comedy duo, Tim and Eric, and how supposedly they got Bob Odenkirk to watch their VHS demo because when they sent it in, they attached an invoice to the outside and proposed to be billing him for having sent the demo, and Bob Odenkirk liked that so much that he watched it. And
that's awesome. All right, so they get this demo, and it's the spring of 1988. They score a gig in New York City, which is 16 hours away from Atlanta. So they drive there, and a guy named George Draculius introduced himself after the gig. Now, George had been Rick Rubin's roommate and partner at Def Jam when Rubin was still running it out of his college dorm room. Now, you may also know the name George Draculius from the Beastie Boys song, B-Boy Bouillabaisse, wherein they proceed to rhyme his last name Draculius with Orange Julius. It's his big claim to fame.
Classic.
So Draculius basically tells him, like, you guys suck. Like, there's something here, but you need a lot of work. And it kind of sent a spark through them. Draculius winds up joining Def American, which became the rock arm of Def Jam Records. So George Draculius did ultimately really shape the sound of this album and the band. He started introducing them to, you know, the open G tunings. He turned Rich Robinson, the guitar player, on to Nick Drake. They just started listening to a real eclectic mix of stuff. Alan, you had mentioned Guns N' Roses. Chris Robinson was also listening to that GNR record and was insistent, like, they needed to be harder. And I think you hear a lot of that on this album, too. I mean, there are some loud guitars on this. They're not so crunchy that it's metal, but there are some heavy guitar tones on this album.
Yeah, there were definitely a few points where it felt like the dueling guitars and that just screaming Les Paul. I don't even know if that's what he played, but that definitely comes through.
Sure. You're in big time. Blasted Rolling Stones, maybe even like Aerosmith territory.
Right.
Yeah. And the open tunings are a huge thing for Keith Richards.
Yeah, the open tunings are cool. Yeah. The open tunings are really cool. I never noticed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. The open tunings, it's funny that I never realized as a kid, as like a 14-year-old, why I couldn't make these songs, make it when I played on guitar, why didn't it sound like the album? You know, like you listen to it and you figure out all the notes and it just didn't sound the same. And it's all about those open tunings that
it was like you were never going to get to those notes. They were never going to be available.
Right, exactly. And I was like, what am I doing wrong? Maybe it's the guitar. Is it the amp? No, it's open tuning, which I didn't discover till, you know, I was like 18 or something, which is pretty sad. All right, so it's 1989. The band is in pre-production. They've got most of the songs written. They've been rehearsing these. So they go into the studio. They lay down all of the tracks after 3 weeks of doing the music. Then they head out to LA and Chris Robinson does most of the vocal tracks. And there was a note from the drummer that said, Chris didn't realize the level of commitment needed to doing vocals in the studio, which makes sense because if I'm honest, he's not that good of a singer live, especially. Like, I feel like there are a lot of notes on this album that this was the first and last time he ever hit those notes was for the Shake Your Moneymaker vocal session. I don't know if it was the drugs, the alcohol, touring too much, but I've seen him live a couple times and I've watched a ton of their live videos and he just doesn't hit the notes. Sometimes he'll drop out for half a verse because there's a high note coming and he just like lets the backup singer sing it. And this is like when he was like 25, he was doing this. So
there's some challenging notes in here. There's no doubt about that, right?
If you know your range and you're in the studio and you're like, okay, I'm writing these songs and I'm at the absolute maximum that I can pull off and you know that you're going to be touring, just drop everything down a whole step. You know,
there's a difference between being able to hit something in your range, but also doing it consistently and repeatedly in a studio setting, especially once you introduce, you know, if you're drinking at all, which I have no reason to think these guys were not in the studio.
They were drinking hard.
All that shit's going to add up. And if these are all open tunings, I wonder if sort of going up or down a key is maybe not as easy. Vocally, I think you'd have to adjust, but I don't know.
That's a good point. If you start, you know, doing all open tunings and dropping stuff, you're going to turn into like, you know, the Deftones, like sludge metal style.
All of it requires a certain level of self-knowledge and preparation, though. That's what I've personally learned is, you're right, discovering your own range and then writing songs in your range or kind of bailing and downgrading in key and arrangement when necessary, any of that kind of stuff. I just wonder if young kids, I know that I certainly had no clue about this until like the last 5 years. So it takes time. It takes guidance from maybe even a producer to get to that. But I'll tell you, it's just funny we're talking about his voice being not so good because I came away from the record thinking, man, this is the greatest asset in the band.
Oh, he sounds great. There's once or twice even on the album doesn't get to the note and it gives it some charm, right?
I made a few notes of some places that you will get into where it's obvious he just can't get there. But I do think he's got a very unique range. Like that high range is not accessible to everybody. It's just a matter of what kind of control do you have over it and how consistent are you with getting into that range? I do agree that is a little bit of a like an X factor for this band.
Well, you know, compare him to a guy like John Fogerty, who we talked about how they're both kind of whiskey drenched, push it hard, rock and roll vocalist. But I can kind of sense that this guy has a lot less control than a guy like John Fogerty.
I mean, Fogerty was a pro though. Like he was dialed.
And also hated by his brother.
Yeah, you're right. Brotherly hatred makes for good rock and roll. All right, so it's late 19, we're now in 1989. They scheduled the release of the album in 1990 and they've done zero promotional planning, no interviews. So they realize they need a manager and a promoter. So they get a guy named Pete Angelis who winds up working with them for the rest of their career. And he manages to cram in like 6 months of promotions and radio stuff all in a couple of weeks. One of my favorite stories was that this promoter, Pete Angelis, before taking them on, wanted to see them live. So they grabbed a club in Atlanta on a Sunday night. No entry, first beer free, and there were 12 people in the room, including the drummer's mother, and the promoter comes out to see them and is like, what the hell am I getting myself into? So I appreciated playing to 12 people and trying to really sell it, because that was most of my musical career.
But the record is tracked at this point? Or this is before?
The record is tracked, yeah. The record is it's done at this point.
Wait, where was the 12-person show?
It was in Atlanta, which is surprising as well, because that was their home court.
Yeah, it feels like they would have built up. This sounds like a bar band that's played a lot of bars successfully to me.
Right.
I feel like I came away with this feeling, especially with some of these earlier tracks on the album, that like I can envision seeing this band playing behind chicken wire at some like roadhouse bar.
Probably my favorite tracks that we're going to get to. So the record sold pretty well. So it took 11 months to sell the first 1 million copies. The second 1 million copies sold in month 12. And then the third 1 million copies sold in month 13. So it was a slow burn for that first year. And then they took off. All right. So let's quickly talk about personnel on this album. So you've got Jeff Cease on lead guitar. And this is something I wanted to ask Phil. When you're Rich Robinson and you're writing all of these songs in open tunings, that's hard to solo with, right?
I would imagine so, right? Like, especially, yeah, I would imagine so. Like, yeah, I'm sure you could write solos, but for me personally, it would be very difficult to improvise, right? Because that's based on a certain understanding of the
neck.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so if you were to picture a piano and you take the A note and you move it to a black key like C sharp.
Well, hold on a second. You're suggesting that even in the studio, he would have to take the same guitar that's tuned to an open key.
No. It was more around, why did they need a lead guitar player if Rich Robinson is the guitar player? So I'm thinking, like, yeah, live to get these sounds, you need to be open tuned, but it's got to be hard to, like, you just can't do a pentatonic. You have to reteach yourself.
Well, there's a lot of slide too, right? And I imagine that's all Robinson.
That's where I feel like soloing would work over an open chord is slide guitar. Right.
But like, also, the soloing is extremely pentatonic. Right?
Sure. Yeah. So, he's not, you know, doing anything crazy, but still.
It's definitely a challenge. But if you're kind of living in that open tuning for a minute, then you just learn your pentatonic patterns in that tuning. It's not that crazy.
Yeah. I was underwhelmed by the solos. I will say, I think the guitar work as a whole was decent. But I think when it came to the solos, I didn't think it was doing much for me. So I don't know if they were just limited by the open tuning or if there's just not.
Well, being the fact that I did think of Guns N' Roses a few times, even before we brought them up here in this conversation, that was not a nice comparison for them guitar wise, because the guitar stands out so much on Appetite for Destruction.
All right, and then on bass, you've got a guy named Johnny Cold. By the way, the guitar player and the bass player, the lead guitar player and the bass player both left, I think, within 6 months of them releasing the album. Steve Gorman, I mentioned, on drums. Chuck Lavelle on keys, who had toured with the Grateful Dead, a very well-known keyboard player who I think actually elevates a lot of these songs from mediocre to outstanding.
I agree.
Some of these tunes are just two chords. Yeah,
I agree. In fact, I was wanting him in more of the songs and turned up farther.
Yeah.
Yeah. He played with the Allman Brothers, didn't he? Or has some connection to that. Yeah. I did think his presence was like, I don't know. I wouldn't say it goes as far as, like, you know, the Billy Preston thing, but like, I think it added something that the band really needed in a lot of these instances. And it was a solid addition.
There's a woman named Laura Creamer who's doing some of the backups that you'll hear on the album. A guy named Brendan O'Brien is the engineer. They list him as doing some other random stuff.
Brendan O'Brien. He's on everything, man.
Is that the same guy?
That's what I'm looking
up
now.
From the Chili Peppers engineer guy? Is that the dude you're talking about? Brendan O'Brien's got to be a fairly common Irish name, I reckon.
Just like George Draculius. And my favorite part was that Rick Rubin was listed as the executive producer, but only after the album became a hit. So there are versions of this album where he's not on it. And then I think once they hit like the 2 million mark, he started to put his name on
it. Yeah, it looks like it is the Brendan O'Brien, who also worked on Super Unknown and Vitology and Purple. Matthew Sweet's 100% Fun.
Adam, are you going to bring up... Is this apocryphal that the Robinson's dad also had a hit song like in the 60s?
In the 60s, like a little doo-wop song, I think. I didn't actually go look it up, but yes, he did have a minor hit.
It's called Boom a Dip Dip.
It's just something about the way Rob pronounces those ridiculous words.
Is that on Spotify?
It is. You got to put dashes in between, and the artist is Stan Robinson, but we'll put that on the playlist.
Oh, yeah. Boom a dip dip. All right. Checking that out. Right
you now. Might need a cleanser. You might need a palate cleanser after the album tonight. So.
Doesn't sound like the Black Crowes, certainly.
All right, so gents, let's jump into some tunes. Now, you'll notice that I have specifically omitted She Talks to Angels and Hard to Handle. Those songs have been covered by a million other things. They've been played 100 million times.
I think you specifically might have talked them to death. But okay.
I just want to put it out there as far as the whole hard to handle thing. I do think She Talks to Angels, great song. I think that's a great song. But Hard to Handle is decent, but I have always had a problem with bands or groups that are introduced to the world through a cover song that is not that dissimilar from the original. I just want to put that out there as all. It's a petty grievance.
I don't think they were expecting for it to do that well. I know they released it as a single, but George Drakoulias convinced nobody wanted to do it because they're like, why? How are we going to touch an Otis Redding tune? Because these guys all loved that music, right?
Yeah. He's also from Atlanta, like them.
Right, exactly. So how are you going to do this? And he convinced them to do it because they would need singles like in other countries on like the Japan release and the Germany release. And they dropped it as a single in the US and it took off.
That was certainly how I was introduced to him, but it wasn't the first single. I don't even know if it was the second single. Maybe I don't
know. The first single was Jealous Again.
Right. So, but that video on MTV is definitely where I heard about them. And so I didn't like it at the time. I like it a little more now, but I hear what Alan's saying. But I think their rationale was also that it was only a B-side for Otis. It wasn't like a major hit.
Right.
So they felt a little more confident with it.
It wasn't Dock of the Bay, right?
Right. Right. Because there would be no point in covering that song. Attention bands. There is no point in you covering Dock of the Bay.
That's a good public service announcement. I like that. All right, let's jump back into the track we played at the top there. This song is called Twice as Hard.
So Adam, you alluded to it when you played a clip earlier, but as a side one, track one, album one, this was a really pleasant surprise for me. This is my favorite track on the record. I had heard it before, I realized, but I had never really actively listened to it. I'd never put this record on actively. So I'm sure I've heard this song in some bar somewhere. You know, it was kind of familiar, but I really think this is them. This is their aesthetic in peak form, in my opinion. They leave a lot of the song itself is quite simple in terms of its chords, but they leave a lot of room for it to breathe in the arrangement. You know, there's a lot of like dropouts and drum things and guitar kind of strumming a chord and holding. So I was like really jazzed for the record after hearing this as the first track.
Yeah, it's a really well arranged Southern rock song.
Yeah, I agree. I thought it was the best song on the album as well. It had a little bit, and this is also, I'm going to repeat myself a few times with some other songs. There's something that felt a little AC/DC-ish about like, maybe it was the intro of the song or something. But yeah, I feel like out of the gate, great album opener, great sort of mission statement type of track. Yeah, it rocks.
It does rock. I also love the guitar layering in this song, again, mm-hmm. like you're saying, out of the gate of what you're going to hear in the rest of the album, I thought the panning of the guitars and the way that they were stacking them was really,
yeah,
really
totally.
Cool.
And you get the open chord immediately, right?
Yeah,
which like
right.
you wouldn't immediately identify as like, oh man, what's happening here, right? But it does set a tone that you're going to get these two guitars and they're going to feel different in a way that you're accustomed to, but not accustomed to.
Well, just for clarity for the audience and for me. Are you saying that the two guitars, that one is an open tuning and the other one's not? And so even though they might be playing the same G chord or whatever, that they sound much more distinct than
two guitars
tuned to standard tuning?
That's what I'm suggesting for sure. Yeah.
Gotcha.
And I think one of them is actually using a slide. As they move through the chords as well. So that's all, I think that's also an open tuning as well. So it's a cool effect out of the gate.
Yeah, I didn't take particular notice of that, but that is a good point. Cause I do think that one of the challenges of being in a band with multiple guitars, or I imagine multiple any instruments, but guitars the most common, is how they don't run into each other. And I do hear a lot of amateurish bands screw it up. You know, so yeah. Finding that area of distinction is a little bit more nuanced and challenging than one might think. Now, I am talking to someone who is guitar player one of three in their band right now.
So. Yes, yes. And that's absolutely true. Yes, it is. It's ongoing work to understand like where you fit on any given song, who's hard in the rhythm section, or maybe you just like can't play with a certain pickup on this song. Yeah, they're just trying to find a space. And then once you get there, you sort of want to, it's yours, right? You don't want anybody.
That's your spot. That's your, you've identified your frequency band for the night. Yeah. Like, all right, I'm going to stay in here.
And then when you can't find a spot, you just come for the bass part.
Just double the bass line. That works. All right, we're going to move on to A Jealous Again, which I think was actually the first single off of this album that was released. I feel like if you turn this up really loud, just on the way that it was mic'd in the room, I feel like you can hear the snare rumbling, kind of like rattling in the background if you crank this as the opening guitar riff is going. And apparently Rich, well, what's the point in saying that a guitar player was known for playing really loud? That's kind of like saying like, oh, well, you know, like we're all breathing air right now. So it's kind of a stupid thing that I was going to say, so I'm not going
to
say it.
Well, I always like to think about the mix dynamics and the power struggle. So I didn't know. I knew this band had two brothers in it, but I listened to this. I first note was piano sounds great. Wish it was turned up higher. Second thought was guitar is turned up too high in relation to that. I bet the other brother is the guitar player.
Yeah, I think this is a pretty good song. It's this apes the Stones thing a little bit much for my liking. And that's a little hard to shake as I'm listening to it. I think maybe they hit the chorus one too many times or something, because it does feel like they hit you over the head with the chorus a little bit. And I think it's a pretty solid song.
You're bringing up a good kind of general complaint I had, which is the songs do kind of go on a little too long for what they are sometimes. And I had, even though the whole record I think is under 45 minutes, so pretty tight, I still kind of had the feeling that I had been through quite a lot after getting through it. And I think it's just because of the arrangement choices. They could have tightened these up a little bit. Do you know what I mean? If I was Rick Rubin or Draculius in the room, my suggestion would have been to cut 30 seconds out of five of the songs and maybe add one more song, something like that.
I do have a little bit of a beef with this song, and it's not actually a problem with the song, but it maybe speaks more to what Rob mentioned earlier about this sort of being a gateway or sort of like later garbage in the late 90s and early 2000s. Something about this song, and I don't know what it is, it just like, it really gives me major Are You Gonna Be My Girl by Jet vibes.
Okay.
Now, again, like, not Black Crow's fault that Jet exists, but that is a problem.
Maybe, well, it is their fault.
Yeah, it might be kind of their fault.
We can do some root cause analysis here.
Okay, so this is what I'm trying to untangle here, because I think I kind of said it at the top, but let me be even more clear. I enjoyed the record. I had relatively low expectations, and I had a fun time listening to it. It's a fun record. Certainly not sorry I listened to it. There are a lot of these rock and roll songs are fun. We're nitpicking, whatever. And it sounds like contextually they were coming at a time when this was not a common thing to be sounding like, this kind of Americana revival. Yeah, they sound like other bands from previous decades, but so what? So does every band. So now Americana revival is its own genre that has been blown out, I would say. It's fucked out. I'm tired of it. I'm over it. You hear it. They literally sell these CDs in Starbucks sometimes, you know? But that's not the Black Crow's fault. So I'm trying to figure out, though, if being a revival band or being a retro band, even at a time when it's not popular, is significant enough to be a must listen. That's my question, right? It's not like, is the music good? I enjoyed the music.
Right.
As I was listening to this again, and being a child of the 90s and MTV, as we all are, we're all very familiar with the band and the hits, but I really hadn't listened to this front to back. I don't think ever. I did get the feeling of like rocking the grill out back, you know, during some hot summer day and had some people over and we're drinking some beers, like, and someone had this on in the background. I'd be like, this is very fitting for this environment. Like it's definitely like a laid back, you know, I would say it's has some fun aspects of it, but I don't think it's breaking any kind of ground, and it doesn't feel to me like it's different enough that it justifies. Well, you know what? I don't want to spoil things too much, but I'm with you, Rob. I'm asking the same questions.
And I'm asking it to Adam specifically, who seems like he's this record's champion. So I'm just directing the rest of our conversation because I'm willing to be swayed, but I need to hear more on that topic.
Sure, sure. No, I mean, I think you make some good points. I think that, yeah, going in the face of, you know, Bon Jovi and a lot of the other hair bands, like these guys felt, and again, not like I was listening to a ton of hair bands at 9 years old, but in retrospect, I knew what those bands were. I remember hearing those.
Sure.
And these guys were somewhat of the antidote to hair metal, which Chris Robinson said was boy bands with chlamydia, which I thought was hilarious. But
That's a good line.
Like the overproduction, because I think it was like Warrant. Like when this was released, I think Warrant had an album and they were out of Las Vegas and they were big and they were lights and they were hair and they were the skin tight leather outfits. They looked like, you know, pro wrestlers and shreddy guitars. And then you have these guys who do that Americana thing. They're not shredding guitars. They're doing simple guitar melodies that are effective. So
that's
kind of how I'm leading.
I hear you, but I was listening to hair metal when I was 9, 10, 11 years old, mostly because that's what MTV was playing. And I've said before on this podcast, the first music I ever bought for myself was Dr. Feelgood as a cassette tape.
That's right.
I just don't see as big a distinction. I agree they're not exactly in the same genre, but they are bands that rock. Like they're carrying some sense of the spirit of rock and roll. And it sounded like your description there of how they're different had a lot more to do with how the people are dressed on stage. So now let me just take a little sidebar to tell you that the Black Crowes dress in a ridiculous manner on stage. And by the Black Crowes, I mean Chris Robinson specifically.
Right, exactly. And we need more scarves and more top hats.
Yeah, like I thought Steven Tyler like cornered the market on scarves,
right,
on the microphone.
Yeah, I was just going to say, so there is an Aerosmith connection.
Yeah, sorry. Well, that's a quick fun thing to throw in. So the Aerosmith thing. So we'll break with the song, but their first big tour to promote this album was opening for Aerosmith. And Joe Perry tried to get them fired because I guess he didn't like the way they sounded or they just weren't good enough or whatever. So
if you're not good enough for like 91 Aerosmith, jeez, come on, man.
Well, it's funny too, because Steve Gorman was saying that they were crushed when they opened for Aerosmith the first time and they realized that when Aerosmith does this thing that they always do is in Love in an Elevator, they all stop playing and they walk up to the microphone and act like they're singing that thing at the end, but it's totally a track and they're lip
syncing. Just piped in.
And they were all crushed because 70s Aerosmith were their heroes. And now they are opening for their heroes. And they're like, oh my God, you guys are faking it. Which I thought was hilarious.
Hold on. Let's dissect this Joe Perry tried to get them fired story, because I have a couple other data points that I think are worth considering and speculating about. One is,
go on.
On the Appetite for Destruction episode, we heard about, this was during Aerosmith's, they got clean and sober and they were kind of on the way climbing back from obscurity. They had been a big band in the 70s and maybe early 80s. They had gone through a trough of drug addiction and no hits or terrible hits, mm-hmm, basically Ragdoll, looking at you. And
dude looks like a lady.
And they were on the way back up, but they were also clean and sober. So when Guns N' Roses was proposed to open for them, I think they played one show or something, and they said, no way, we can't be around these guys. They're doing too many drugs.
Right.
We haven't talked about Black Crowes drug use yet, but that could have been a factor. Just throwing that out there. And two, I heard several anecdotes about Chris Robinson not getting along with other musicians. He seems like a prickly pear to me. He apparently had this longstanding feud with John Poplar.
I didn't read that, but that's about right. So Chris Robinson had a penchant for running his mouth about other bands, To which their manager, Pete Angelus, was like, why are you doing that? He's like, if you want to sell albums, you can't go shitting on other people's, the rest of their record collection. Like, they're entitled to like that. You don't have to crap on that. But the light beer thing comes from, they ultimately finish the Aerosmith tour and they get on the ZZ Top summer tour. And at this point, ZZ Top is over the top with big endorsements from, what was it, Miller Lite or something. And it's
got the
basic
spinning guitars.
Yeah, right. Like, it's completely commercialized. It's a joke, right? And so they get a second gig opening for them. And in some interview, Rich Robinson said something about not liking light beer. Not that he didn't like Bud Light or Miller Lite, but that he just didn't like light beer. Somebody read this and was like, oh my God, he's shitting on the sponsors. So they try to tell him to stop talking to the press. And then he goes off in this big thing about like free speech, you can't censor me. And ultimately they wanted to get off this tour because they had enough fans that they could start headlining. So they basically staged this huge battle with ZZ Top and their sponsors and ultimately got kicked off the tour.
Was ZZ Top in on it?
ZZ Top just wanted money.
Bass player is like, I've worked at the airport. I'm good with where we're at.
That's right. The ZZ Top guy was a baggage handler.
Feeling pretty all right about this.
To be fair, I can think of a period of in my life where I would have gone on a Miller Lite, you know, crusade.
Oh, hell yeah. I would do that right now. It gave me $500,000 to play a couple chords.
Dude, LaGrange, yeah, like 200 times next year, no problem.
Yeah. I'm definitely pro ZZ Top in that story. But but just to be clear, that does suck about Aerosmith using tape effects. But I'll tell you what I would have accepted. I would have accepted guys standing off stage out of the spotlight singing the part instead. That would have been better for me.
Yes, they have a barbershop quartet with their top hats all just around a single microphone. Hit it.
Because to me, there is a fine but a very important line, a distinction between lip syncing and farming out the parts you can't do anymore. So in other words, if they still gave Steven Tyler a part, but it wasn't the same part he sang on the record, and someone kind of off stage, not technically in the band, was singing it, as I believe you told us once, Adam, was the case when you saw Aerosmith.
Yeah,
that
right.
That works perfectly fine for me. The times I've seen Steely Dan, I noticed they did that very deftly with some of Fagan's vocals. He was still singing, but he just wasn't singing the same note. Someone else was covering that note. That seems like a totally reasonable compromise to me.
All right, let's jump back into the tunes. We're going to dive into a song called Thick and Thin. All right, there you have it. Just so you know, that sound effect was not just pulled from some random sound effects album. They actually went to the parking lot of the recording studio with the drummer's 1972 Dodge Dart and crashed it into a dumpster to get that sound.
Oh, it was a dumpster. The note I made was, is that a car crashing into trash cans at the beginning?
It was a dumpster. Apparently, they ran hundreds of feet of mic cables, you know, through the rooms, up the stairs, out the windows, and set all the mics up, and then crashed it.
Who said they weren't professionals? Come on.
Right.
I mean, you know a song's a piece of trash when you kick it off by crashing a car into a dumpster.
Yeah. I just wrote, could be any band, anytime, ever.
This sounded to me like a, you know, those jam along tracks that are on YouTube.
Oh man,
that's rough.
You just type in blues jam and C or rockabilly jam and C, you know, and it comes up on YouTube.
I don't know. That's what I felt listening to the song.
Yeah, this was easily my least favorite song on the record, but mostly because it just like kind of, yeah, it was just so stock.
This was one of the more unintelligible songs. I'd mentioned that he was unintelligible. I had such a hard time. I mean, I honestly could have just brought up the karaoke thing on Spotify. I didn't, but I still have, you know, this 30 years after the fact, I still have no idea what he's saying 90% of the time on most of these songs.
I think he hears the clock ticking. Something
and
about
a Landcroft bitching. I don't know.
This record really does sound great, though. I think this song, what's interesting about this song to me is like the breakdown, sort of like towards the end. It's like one of the few times in the record where I think you can really hear like the sound of the drums sort of like breathing for two reasons. One, just, you know, it's mixed that way. And two, it's just like the tempo is slow enough when they do the drum breakdown. It just reminds me that the record really is recorded, like produced very nicely. Sounds great. Great job, Brendan O'Brien.
Yeah, they definitely have a nice live band feel. It feels like you just walked in on a very well mic'd room and we're totally watching this band play, you know, and that's a good thing.
And the vocals on some of the songs sound like that too. Like some of the vocals sound like he's in a big room, which is cool.
All right. So we're going to jump in next to a song called Seeing Things. And this is the one, not the one, but one of the songs where I really think the keyboards elevate this song to more than just an A B chord pattern. Like if you were to see this live and they didn't have the Hammond and they didn't have the piano and it was just guitar, just don't play it.
Yeah.
Yes. It's, I feel like it'd be real. Now I do think that Chris does a great job on this song. There are a couple times where he's stretching, yeah, but it's got a good feel. And I feel like he's pouring himself out in the studio, like as hard as he could. So while he's not, you know, A440 perfect tuning, I feel like it hits pretty hard.
Yeah, I agree.
A complaint first and then a compliment. I had this marked on my first listen as Wednesday's Gone.
Oh, I actually had this as the Joe Cocker version of With a Little Help from My Friends. Nice. Did anyone else pick up on that? I don't know.
I didn't, but now I can hear it now that you say that.
But yeah, I also timestamped this particularly kind of near the end. Oh, the song's too long. That would be my real complaint about it. But I think it's about 3:54. He hits some real high notes, mm-hmm, maybe, and then and over the next 30 seconds where he squeaks it out a little. But I actually like it.
Yeah, I can respect going for it a little bit. I do think this was one of the times, probably around the 4 minute mark ish, where it's clear that he's out of his range. But I'm in favor of not going for like the perfectionist thing all the time, especially for a band like this.
Yeah, and I know there were maybe a couple other times. Just the mixing of the female backups with Chris's voice just felt like a nice change from getting kind of battered by his timbre is pretty similar song to song. And so my ear just got a little beaten up by that over the 45 minutes.
I also think the backups here, like they and maybe even in a strange way, the Leslie, right? Like they sympathize for him maybe not getting to some of the notes in a way that, like, again, it works with the arrangement. You're getting everything you need. And again, he's going for it. And that's sort of like you get the energy of that.
It's a really interesting point. I think that is a trick of how that type of arrangement is used. When you have really strong backing vocals, like these female backing vocals in this chorus, and then you have the lead singer kind of reaching for it, I always, in my ear, and I didn't even realize, I just was subconsciously thinking this, it feels like the backing vocals are like pulling him up a ledge or something. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
Because yeah, they're so solid.
Yeah, I did think one of the things I did like about the song, and I didn't think it was great. I thought it was a little filler-ish, but it did have a bit of feeling for me. But I heard in this song a little bit of this like new country wave of guys like Chris Stapleton and you know, some of those other folks where they're not borrowing from the Black Crowes, but I do think this sound seems to be like really a little bit more in vogue right now.
There's something more authentic here. Yeah. It's like the Muscle Shoals sound.
Yeah. I don't know. I think it's like, it's a little bit of an enduring, you know, type of sound to this song.
I thought this song built really well out of all the songs on the album, building to a crescendo, because I don't think the first chorus comes in until 2:20, but even as it's approaching, you know something's coming. That the song is slow and it drags a certain amount, but it allows it to build up this tension that when they come in with that chorus, it's like, oh, thank God, that's what we've been waiting for. And they only hit the chorus twice. And granted, I know the outro is a bit long, but I actually enjoy the vamp. It's 5:18 long, and I feel like the last minute and a half is just them vamping on seeing things. But I feel like it's at such a fevered pitch that it works to carry you out of the song.
Mm-hmm. I think I would have liked it to carry me out of the album. I think it feels like a last track. Okay. It feels like a good closer for the night kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And so I guess what I'm saying is, yeah, based on the arrangement and the writing in this song, the longer runtime is kind of justified. But the fact that it was just smack dab in the middle of the record seemed a little odd to me.
Well, especially when you see what they closed the album with, which we'll get to. I definitely agree with that.
All right, so let's move on. This next tune is called Strutting Blues. So this is actually my favorite song on the album.
Uh-oh.
Really?
Yeah. Interesting.
This rocks hard, and it's got a couple different sections that I think keep it moving. There's like a halftime thing that they do. Uh-huh. There's a little mini organ solo and the turnaround.
So Adam, we can have our Black Crowes little like moment here now, right? Because like okay. I've made some notes on this too, that I think in a lot of ways, this is like the most Black Crowes song on the record. This sounds like a Morica, right? So this sounds like something that's going to come later. And in that way, I feel like this is actually what the Robinson Brothers songwriting sounds like. The other stuff is maybe a little more heavily influenced by like, you know, just trying to be popular, right? But I think this I think it has a different excitement, because it's like you can tell this is a new sound for them.
See, this didn't bounce off me that way at all. It's so funny to hear what you're saying. I thought my brain kind of tuned out with that opening guitar figure, which kind of runs through the song. I was just like, boring.
Oh yeah, where it sounds like Jet. Yeah, we're right back into Jet. Yeah, it starts very boring. Yeah, the good stuff's in the middle.
Maybe I'm listening to something different. I don't know. Rob, I'm with you. I wrote down that this might possibly be one of the most unremarkable songs that we've done on this podcast. I'm not saying it's one of the worst. I felt like nothing listening to this. Like it inspired no feelings of anything inside of me. And so I don't know. That was just it felt like very like basic bar rock to me anyway.
There's a breakdown that comes to like two minutes, like 2:15, that I feel like is pretty awesome.
Yeah, they do that thing where they modulate it a whole step, And then they groove on like the pre-chorus for a little while. And then they do that Guns N' Roses thing where they take the guitar solo up. So the song's in G, the guitar solo is played in C sharp, and then they come back to G, which resolves really nicely.
I mean, I'll give it another shot, I guess, but it washed off me like rain. And it's, you mentioned their later record, Amorica. So I just took a quick glance through their next two records. I'm not at all familiar with them other than whatever radio hits there might be. But I kind of immediately noticed that Amorica sounded a little more, just a little more distinguished and a little less purely retro. So maybe that's what you're trying to say. Obviously, I'm speaking from an uneducated opinion on Amorica, having only listened to like half of it once, but it struck me that I might appreciate that record a little more.
Well, they did evolve a little bit, didn't they? Into, I'm not that familiar with it, but I've seen them described as evolving almost into like jam band ish sort of Government Mule type of territory, whether you like that or not. I mean, it's definitely different than what's on this album.
Apparently, Chris Robinson went through a Grateful Dead phase.
Interesting.
Again, in the book, Steve Gorman's book was like, that was the worst time because you had a bunch of stoners and Grateful Dead fans who were so lackadaisical that they wouldn't even clap. And then you had the actual fans who were so angry at the jam band that like literally no one was clapping.
You just brought back such like, a memory for me. I was at Bottom of the Hill one time, I think it was with James, and we were like one of, you know, there's 10 people in a 300 size club, and this band was one of the loudest bands I've ever heard play, and I partly because there weren't enough human bodies to absorb the sound, and I was stoned off my gourd, and I remember, but we were standing up front and everything, we were like paying attention, I was into the music. And the bass player called me out from stage for not clapping. So I was just standing there staring at him like stonedly.
Oh my God.
I think they were pissed that there was no one there, but
look, I think the bass player is just, they're just edgy. You know, they're like just looking for something.
They've already been relegated to bass.
Yeah, right. They've already failed at guitar. Now.
All right, let's roll it on here. This is the last track on the album, the last track on our focus list. This song is called Stare It Cold.
What does this sentiment mean? Can someone explain that to me?
I have no clue.
Staring at cold? Dude, I stare at cold all the time, man. When I'm on a bus, I'm staring at cold. When I'm making omelets, I'm staring at cold. I have no idea what the hell this song means.
Why close the album with this? I don't, that's what I don't understand.
Well, I like that they ended the album on this because of the gospel double time at the very end. It almost feels like you're walking out of church in the South. An all-out party. I at least appreciated that.
There is no information on what Stare It Cold means. It's just info on the Black Crowes. It's like
maybe it was too hip for everyone to get behind.
I just feel like this was another one that they should have tightened up. I hear what you're saying about the very end, but halfway through the song, it basically restarts. Like they stop and then restart the song. And like a two-act play, the second act should be shorter.
That's a good songwriting tip there, Rob. Thank you. Again, so kids, if you're listening, don't cover Dock of the Bay. And if you're going to stop and restart your song, make the second half shorter.
I have a long list of uncoverable songs, by the way. Maybe you can collaborate on that.
Well, we need a playlist.
A public playlist for this. write in and let us know your thoughts. There was a cool rhythm thing they did at the end, the drummer did, that I still can't figure out, where like they swapped the kick and the snare, or there's something going on. Yeah, it was just a little flavor thing that I still haven't been able to figure out, but they all wind up landing on one at some point. So well done, Steve Gorman.
I thought the drums on the album in general were executed well and recorded well and mixed well. Like, I have no complaints with the drums at all. Like, I think that those shined through, in my opinion.
We're finished our focus list. Now we're going to throw things around the room to get those votes on whether or not you actually need to hear this album. We're going to throw it over to Alan.
It's going to be a no for me. And it goes against slightly some of my criteria that I've been consistent about, which is if there's an album with really good songs, which I do think She Talks to Angels, which we didn't talk about much, it is a really good song. And I tend to think that the idea is you're listening in a vacuum and you haven't already heard some of these songs. And so I do think you should hear that song, but there's just not enough here for me to feel like it's a must listen. You know, for all the shit that I kind of talked about it, I do think it was kind of fun, to Rob's point. I just didn't feel like there was anything different enough that you have to carve out an hour of your life and you have to listen to this. So I'm going to say no.
All right, Phil.
So I'm going to go the opposite direction and I'm going to give it a yes this week. I mean, there's definitely like some nostalgia in this for me. So, you know, I definitely come in biased, but I think in a different way. I think as far as just 90s rock records go, you know, I think this is an interesting counterpart to Guns N' Roses, although very different. I think it is a precursor to Lenny Kravitz, but it's also not the grunge thing that will come later. And also, I think it's probably better than a lot of the Rolling Stones records that were coming out, you know, after, you know, I don't want to put a date on it because those Stones records are really good until they're not, right? But I'm sure we could draw a line in the sand there. I'm going to give this a yes.
All right, Rob.
Man, I've been really conflicted about it, but I'm going to ultimately go no. It's a bit of a squeaker for me. It just doesn't quite make the threshold. I enjoyed it. It was fun, and I would put it on again in the context that Alan described, at a backyard barbecue with other red-blooded Americans. That sounds fun to me. However, what I'm most concerned about in this list of must-hears is, you know, how it fits into the musical canon, what kind of musical movements it kicks off, who it influences. To me, that is more important than just a fun record. So although I liked it, I don't think it's necessary.
All right. That's a no from Rob. All right. This is Adam. And I specifically remember when I was 11 or 12, I think I usurped this album from my sister, who was a bit older than me and had enough money for the Columbia House subscription. So I remember she had Stick It To You from Slaughter, Martika, which if you remember her, it was Toy Soldiers was the big song, Debbie Gibson, New Kids on the Block, and then Shake Your Moneymaker. And this album stood out amongst all of those as what my dad would ultimately call, like, this is rock and roll.
Compared to those paragons of rock music. Huh?
I haven't heard the name Slaughter in reference to the band in like 30 years.
So I remember this album and just being blown away as a kid, because I think this might have been one of like the first modern hard rock albums or Southern rock albums that I'd heard. I grew up listening to 70s rock, but this was the first one that I felt like I owned. It was of my generation. Granted, I was, you know, 10, 11, 12 when I first heard it. But I do think that this was a classic album from the 90s that you do need to hear. So probably no big surprise, but it's going to be a yes from me. And if I recall, it's going to be Tie to the Runner. So we're going to say that Shake Your Moneymaker from the Black Crowes is on the list, despite some objections. So congrats, boys. There's only two of you left in the band. Everything fell apart over the last 32 years, but I'll keep listening to the discography as well. Amorek is great, by the way, Rob. So if you're looking for a little more,
I'll check it out.
All right, so let's dive into the listener mailbag. We're going to throw things over to Rob.
Hey, thanks so much, Adam. We've been getting a lot of mail lately. I think we might have ticked off a few people, but in any case, I have some mail to read here.
Buckle up.
The formula is working.
No, these aren't too bad, actually. But the first one comes from Lucille from the UK, yet another female, presumably. I found your show through the Deloused episode. She's referring to the Mars Volta episode. Only after realizing I was a fan of Mars Volta quite literally the day before. And it was a lot like listening to my own opinions on the record at the same time as you guys were voicing. The format of the podcast and the casual but opinionated tone was something I've really been missing in terms of music discussion. So by all means, thanks a ton for doing it. Also love Sparks. I'm a huge Sparks fan. Drive Like Jehu.
Oh.
In the air episodes as well.
Wow.
Interesting.
A Jehu fan. Nice.
And they stuck with us.
And they stuck with us. I actually think, we ended up saying we liked Jehu, though. It kind of grew on us.
Right.
I didn't say that.
Duly noted. Okay, we have one more, a quick one from Roger, who doesn't tell us where he's writing from, but he does mention he's a German expat. So I assume that means that he's a German living away from Germany. He says, love the chemistry between you guys. You crush most other music podcasts in terms of musical knowledge and theory. The Nena Cherry episode is probably one of the funniest things I've heard in my life. Yeah. Keep up the good work.
I might go back and listen to that just for grins.
I am extremely proud of that episode. I thought it was, so I agree with our listener. Thank you.
Yeah, she was exceptionally terrible. So. Yeah. So thank you. Thank you for writing in. And we just want to encourage you, if you have anything to say about any of the opinions we've expressed here, I know there are a lot of big Black Crowes fans out there. Feel free to yell at us or post us to a Black Crowes forum or shoot us an email at 1001albumcomplaints@gmail.com. We'll take everything you write into our hearts and maybe even read it on air.
Awesome. Thank you, Rob. And buckle up, Rob. I've got another way for folks to get in touch with us. So new this week, we're trying something different. It's pretty cool. It's pretty easy. If you're too lazy to email, I get it. And Lord knows I would be. So you can now point your browser or your phone to sayhi.chat/1001. If you can't remember that, just go to the episode notes on this episode. We'll have a link. What you'll do is it'll bring you up to a quick audio recorder. You can record a message and send it to us. We'll either play it on the air or just read the transcription on the air for you. Again, if you're too lazy to email, I get it. I would be as well. All right, so next up, we are going to... Actually, we're not going to spin the Albinator. If I recall, Rob, keep me right here. Next week is our 100th episode.
That is correct, Adam. We've made it.
I hope we do Slaughter.
99 in the bag, coming up on 100. That is amazing. And we are going to be reviewing Led Zeppelin 2, which if you recall, our premiere episode, our debut episode was Led Zeppelin 1. So we're rounding things out. Every 100 episodes, we're going to do a Zeppelin album. So we hope you stick around for the next 5 to 8 years.
Well, and then once we finally complete the list, then we'll do a Greta Van Fleet album just to like close the loop.
I love taking it back to the beginning, and I love part of the homework here will not just be listening to Led Zeppelin 2, we'll be listening to our own baby voices from so long ago.
Just about two years ago.
Yeah.
Wow. Man, well, that is very exciting. All right, folks, you have your homework along with us. It is Led Zeppelin 2. We'll be bringing our hot takes and I'm sure some love as well. So that's going to do it for us here today at 1001 Album Complaints. I'm Adam.
I'm Alan.
I'm Phil.
And I'm Rob.
Boosh.
Boom a dip dip, boom a dip dip.